Good morning, everybody. So the next instruction course is on diagnosis and management of macular and submacular pathology. And for this, we have on keynote address that will be on the suprachoroidal space from a potential space to a space with potential. It will be delivered by Dr. Ilad Moiseev, Associate Professor of Ophthalmology, Chairman, Department of Ophthalmology, Meir Medical Center, Kfar Saba, Israel. Sir is there. Dr. Ilad Moiseev, please. Dr. Ilad Moiseev, please.
Okay, you can talk last then.
Is there? So if Professor Moiseev is not there, so we can put the keynote address whenever he turns up. But I should give the introduction also. Professor Moiseev is a graduate of Sackler School of Medicine at the Tel Aviv University. And he did his residency at Tel Aviv Center and Vitreoretinal Surgery Fellowship in UC Davis, California, USA. And areas of expertise is VR surgery, cataract, ocular trauma. And he is very active in research, teachings, has multiple publications in peer-reviewed journals, and has presentations in numerous national and international meetings, and received multiple awards. He is also a member of Board of Israeli Ophthalmology Society and Head of Meeting Committee. Dr. Moiseev, please. Okay, I think he's not there. So we start our topics, and then when professor comes, we can continue. So first speaker is Dr. Rajesh Sahai. He will speak about the vitreomacular traction and epiretinal membrane. Dr. Rajesh, please.
Good morning. So epiretinal membranes are cellular proliferation on the inner retinal surface. The prevalence is 7 to 12%.
No.
And it is bilateral up to 31%. Thank you.
Judge, load it in.
And the prevalence was significantly increased after cataract surgery. Even those patients who did not have any pre-surgery retinal involvement had something like 9% increase in the formation of retinal membranes. And it can be classified as idiopathic, secondary, or iatrogenic. Clinically, grade 0 is when there is no underlying retinal distortion. Grade 1 is irregular wrinkling of the inner retina. Grade 2 is opaque membrane obscuring the underlying vessels and marked retinal distortion, as you see in the third picture. The symptoms range from none to decreased vision, monocular diplopia, or metamorphopsia. More so when the patient's dominant eye is affected. Can have hemorrhages, hard and soft exudates due to breakdown of blood retinal barrier. CME results with persistent vitreomacular traction, and it may be associated with macular holes and pseudo holes. The separation of the posterior vitreous cortex and the internal limiting lamina causes PVD, which is seen 53% in patients under 50 years of age and 65% over 65 years. And it causes micro holes in the ILM, allowing the glial cells to migrate on the surface of retina and formation of ERM. Secondary gliosis results due to retinal injury and diseases. And in the absence of PVD, chronic irritation of the macular cells, mechanical traction, causes gliosis. OCT shows a hyperreflective layer on the retinal surface, as you see in this photograph. There is thickened outer retina and disruption of the photoreceptor layer. FFA can be a useful tool in cases where there is underlying vascular disease or CNV. Surgery is the management, And indications are when the vision is less than 618, there is disturbing diplopia and metamorphopsia. Preoperative visual acuity, central foveal thickness, integrity of the ISOS junction decides the outcome. And usually, improvement of two or more lines is seen in 6 to 12 months. And improvement in contrast sensitivity and stereopsis is actually more useful for the patient because it adds quality to life. Of course, there is a compromise in outcome if there are pre-existing macular pathology. So video to show you. Where do I get this? It's an induction of the PVD. There's a routine case where you induce a PVD and then start peeling the ERM. So nothing great about it, but let's move on to the it doesn't change, man. Sometimes you'll come across tough membranes. So these are very adherent membranes on the retina. Every time you'll give a pull, the retina will also be lifted up. And there are chances of iatrogenic macular hole formation. Are they playing or not?
No.
Why? Why videos are not playing, man? It's playing here. It's playing here.
No, not here.
Shall I go to the previous video?
Yeah.
So that's a routine one. This is more interesting. So there's induction of the PVD and removal of the ERM. This is a more difficult, this is a tougher ERM, where I was telling you that whenever you give a pull, the retina is also pulled up. And there'll be a chance of formation of iatrogenic macular hole. You see there, do we have the pointer? You see there is a chance of deroofing and iatrogenic macular hole formation. Oh yeah. So to avoid this, let me show with the animation. So if you pull it like this, you'll definitely cause a macular hole. So try releasing it from all the other sides and then peel it over the fovea. So usually saves bigger problems. Okay. Another video where it was very difficult to find a cleavage between the ERM and the retina. Bilan blue dye was used to stain the ILM. Sorry. So this is after the stain. Yeah. And then you peel it off along with the ERM. So then this is another OCT finding where there is a lamellar hole associated epiretinal proliferation. These are homogeneous membranes of moderate reflectivity. This is a thicker epiretinal membrane without evidence of any traction and has visible connections to the middle layers. So that makes it very difficult to remove. And the fovea is thinner, and there is higher prevalence of ellipsoid zone disruption. And because of this, they have very poor visual acuity. So exact pathology is not known, could be a result of associated outer retinal injury. So this is a lamellar macular hole, and you see a thicker membrane here, which is growing inside. That is the LHEP. These are the different cuts. Here you see, and this grows underneath the hanging edges of the retina. So very difficult. This is post-surgery, where this membrane has been peeled and filled. The hole was filled with the same membrane. Now coming to the vitreomacular traction. So when the liquefaction and dehiscence of the vitreoretinal interface do not match, this causes anomalous PVD. So this results in VMA, where there is no distortion of the retina, or VMTS, where distortion of the foveal surface without full thickness interruption of the retinal layers. It could be focal, over. It could be focal, it could be broad, and it may result in vitreoschisis, exudative ARMD, retinal tears. So there's a broader classification where grade 0 is the VMA and grade 4 is the macular hole with no vitreous attached to it. So the pathogenesis is the same, is the constant mechanical stress to Müller cells, release of inflammatory factors, breakdown of blood retinal barrier, disturbed macular microcirculation and CME, and symptoms of course is decreased vision and all other distortion of vision. It may result in macular holes, ERMs, and retinoschisis may develop. Sometimes spontaneous separation can occur in these cases when the myofibroblasts grow into the vitreous. So once there is a pull, it pulls off the ERM and the vitreous. So the treatment is gas injection. You can give 0.3 milliliter of C3F8 or SF6, and it can induce PVD in 25% of cases. One series has recorded 40% success at 1 month and 60% at 3 months. Pharmacological vitrolysis by microplasmin, MIVI trust showed release rate of 26.5% in VMA at 28 days. The surgery is the mainstay, and this is how we operate, and we remove the VMT. Thank you.
Next we have Dr. Abhijit Chattopadhyay. He is the chief instructor for this course. He is a senior vitreoretinal surgeon in Priyamvada Birla Eye Hospital in Calcutta. He is heading the vitreoretina department, and he'll be talking to us on macular hole in attached and detached retina.
I think George is right.
So sorry for the interruption. There is some delay, but we'll manage in time definitely. So this is the macular hole in attached and detached retina, and no financial interest involved. This is an important slide. So this is first described by Knapp in 1869 and modern concept and classification by Gass. And there are different studies selling prevalence from 3.3% to 1.7% and bilateral in up to 11.1% cases. So Kelly and Wendell first time reported in archives of ophthalmology in 91 about the surgery. And successful closure of macular hole in 58% of cases they showed. And then recent closure rates are 95% about. So diagnosis initially it is by Sidla microscopy, but it is replaced by OCT. And you can see there is a lamellar macular hole and the pseudo hole, which we can see in OCT nicely with the infus and the normal. The classification already described by Dr. Rajesh Sahai, the correlation between the stages of macular hole biomicroscopy originally described by Dr. Gass, and then the OCT recently came, and the international VMT classification, which you can get it. And then this is the working classification of the commonly used working classification for full thickness macular hole. There's a stage two is a small hole with a small or medium full thickness macular hole with vitreomacular traction. Stage three is a large hole with medium or large full thickness macular hole with vitreomacular traction. And stage four is full thickness macular hole with PVD, with small, medium, or large full thickness macular hole without vitreomacular traction. And stages of macular hole, you can see that stage one is the impending macular hole, and the stage 1B is an occult. And there is one 3D structure, if you see, nowadays the OCT is so much telling, and which Dr. Gass, all the things he got with the Sidlam biomicroscopy, that is wonderful to think of now. And if we see the prognostic indicators of the macular hole surgeries, there are lots of prognostic indicators, like the size of macular hole diameter, that is the most important, they found it. And then the morphology and thickness of the foveal photoreceptor layers, and defected in interdigitation zone, external limiting membrane or ellipsoid zone. And then OCT parameters also came, like hole forming factor, macular hole index, traction hole index. And then also computerized aerial designing software came for the measurement of the macular hole volume. So there are plenty of indicators. And this is the practical things which we come for the surgeries, like dyes we use for the macular hole surgeries evolved over the years from triamcinolone acetonide to indocyanine green to trypan blue and brilliant blue. And the adjuvants we use, autologous serum, platelet concentration, fibrinogen, you will find lots of papers published, the tissue adhesive, transforming growth factor beta 2 and the thrombin also. And the instruments we use, the ILM forceps, diamond duster scraper, finesse loop, peak, even I say the PFCL is also one of the most important instruments. So we go to the inverse flap technique, that's all small cuts. And if we can see it, this is the here. The first video is not playing, but the second time we can see, we just peel the flaps all over, and we're just trimming now, and with the cutter, close so that the no extra flap is there. And making it smaller so that it fits nicely. And the tricky part is the fluid exchange, because if we are not careful during the last stage of the fluid exchange, those flaps may come into the extrusion cannula. And so slowly you do, and then the flap automatically goes inside the macular hole. And it is the very next, if you can see, we put mostly SF6 here, and then you see this is a closed macular hole nicely, but you can see the tissues already inside. It's not organized well till now, but over the time it will be okay. There is one traumatic macular hole we can see where uh, They're not playing. Or how to play them? You're just playing back, back, back. No, it came the next. What's that mean? What is happening? System crashed. Something is there in the system also. This is not on the computer. Yeah. Thank you. Stabilized now. Thank you. And this is a traumatic macular hole surgery. This is a full thickness macular hole you can see, and the papillomacular bundle you can see. This is the badly damaged already, and this is the the surgical steps, if you see. So what we did with the loops, we just Cox and Castles, whatever membrane ILM is possible, because this type of holes you may think that it is not possible to do anything, but we did a good job. In fact, you see, I think it is not possible to get the about 3/4 portion of the ILM. You cannot peel, this is all scarred. So from the temporal, whatever is available, we just took it with the lip and put it into the hole. And we should be very careful, because the all over the retina is thin now. And if you see, then we did the fluid air exchange and put the gas. And if you see the result, and the hole is closed. Okay, and if you see the OCT, you see the nicely closed, whatever is that, a type 2 closer maybe, but because the papillomacular bundle retina is missing completely all the layers, so it increased the vision by 2 lines. I think for this patient it is good. And then the temporal flap also we do sometimes, and that is also, instead of pulling all the flaps from everywhere, we just take the temporal flaps and put them back and keep the papillomacular bundle area. In fact, if it fails somehow, we can use those flaps also. And that also is the same way, but it is much, you can say, safer, and the other procedures is the same. And result is good only. And this is a RD with the macular hole here. After the usual vitrectomy procedure and inducing the posterior vitreous detachment, there is one hole through which we drained and put PFCL. And then we immediately under PFCL, we put the dye. And there is the advantage of BB dye below the PFCL is immediately you can start the peeling without waiting for the staining and other things. And that is, in fact, much easier than, I should say, the peeling in the attached retina maybe. And then the normal way you finish the OT. So this is the RD with macular hole surgery. You can see it's nicely closed. And the media is not so clear due to the silicone oil post-op. Thank you. And sorry for the disturbance in the video. So our next speaker will come. So Dr. George Manayath, he will speak on management of failed macular hole surgery. And He is a professor and senior consultant in Aurobindo Eye Hospital, Coimbatore. He has plenty of peer-reviewed journal publications along with the book chapters also, and definitely presentations is various conferences. Dr. George.
So we have heard about macular hole surgeries alone. Let us see how you manage a case of failed macular hole surgery or recalcitrant macular holes. So before going to management of failed surgeries, let us look what is a successful macular hole surgery. Success is type 1 closure, where the foveal defect is closed with the intact ellipsoid zone of the outer photoreceptors, and type 2 closure, which could be V-type or U-type, where there is a foveal defect, though the edges of the macular hole are attached to the RP. So U-type closure is a failed, considered to be a failed macular hole surgery. Some of the small macular holes close from inside out. So these small outer lamellar holes might take long time for it to reorganize. So these are not failed macular hole surgeries. So for a macular hole surgery, it is defined should adequate ILM peeling with long-acting gas tamponade. Sufficient gas tamponade is a must before we call it a failed surgery. So risk factors for non-closure includes large macular holes greater than 800 microns, smallest minimum hole diameter, chronic macular holes with subretinal precipitates, large myopic macular holes, and large traumatic macular holes are risk factors for non-closure. The surgical techniques that are described include the inverted flap techniques that we already saw is to prevent a failed macular hole surgery in large macular holes. Simplest procedure is repeat fluid gas exchange for early failure of surgery. And the commonest procedure is ILM free flap technique transplantation. And also success has been reported with lens capsular flap transplantation. And rarely described techniques is autologous full thickness retinal free flap and amniotic membrane transplantation, and arcuate retinotomy for relaxing incision also have been described. So coming to the first is inverted flap technique. This is to prevent a failure of macular hole surgery in large macular holes. So this was described by Navraki first, wherein radial flaps are raised from the arcade area towards the macular hole, and it is left at attached to the edge of the macular holes, and multiple radial flaps are raised like this. These flaps leaving and plugging the hole not only provides a scaffold for the migration of Müller cells, but it has neurotrophic factors which help in the survival of photoreceptors and Müller cells. So here, after raising multiple flaps after staining of the ILM, these with low suction of the vitrectomy cutter, these multiple flaps attached to the lips of the hole are trimmed, and after fluid air exchange, the frill of ILM is gently plugged into the macular hole with a soft tip cannula. So this is basically to prevent a failure of macular hole surgery, and long acting C3F8 gas is put for larger holes. So coming to the first procedure, that is a repeat fluid gas exchange. This is usually done for early failure of holes within 2 weeks or 3 weeks of macular hole surgery. If the hole is open like this with a cuff of subretinal fluid and elevated edges or lips of the macular hole, rather than a flat punched out hole, this has a high chance of closure with repeat fluid gas exchange. This type of early failure is either due to an inadequate positioning or inadequate tamponade, short tamponade. So these are case examples where after the failed surgery, only a repeat fluid gas exchange have resulted in type 1 closure. So coming to the most popular procedure, which is a ILM free flap transplantation taken from the edge of the already peeled area of ILM, larger than macular hole diameter, ILM is taken and placed over the macula before gas tamponade. So here, this is a modified technique, not the original one. The original one, the limitation was when you take the flap from the already peeled area and try to put it over the macula, because it's flimsy and thin, these flaps, ILM flaps, free ILM flaps tend to float around in the or get lost in the BSS. So here a moderate size perfluorocarbon bubble is placed, and under the PFCL from the edge of the already peeled area, a reasonably sized flap is raised and larger than the macular hole diameter, and it is under the PFCL, it is just dragged and put on the macula hole. It is not taken out of the PFCL and reintroducing and putting on the macula is difficult in this situation. And a gentle fluid air exchange is done so that the flap doesn't get dislodged from the macular hole. And then a long acting gas tamponade is done. So this is the free flap, ILM free flap transplantation. A similar technique has been described, but a hinged flap from the already peeled area. It is hinged so that it doesn't get lost. So the flap, hinged flap is put over the macular hole and gas tamponade. Also, it has been described with success, the lens capsular transplantation. After the trypan blue staining of the posterior capsule, a small piece of the posterior capsule is pinched with a micro forceps, and under air or under BSS, this small capsular flap is placed over the macula. Viscoelastic, a drop of viscoelastic help in placing this hole in position so that it doesn't get float away, and this acts as a scaffold for the migration of Müller cells under this lens capsular flap and results in closure of these recalcitrant large macular holes. So here you can see after gas exchange and around 2 weeks, the macular hole started closing, and at around 1 month, the hole is closed. Similarly, anterior capsule transplantation, especially if a phakic eye undergoing a cataract surgery along with a recalcitrant macular hole surgery, the rexus, the trypan blue stained anterior capsule is preserved in a petri dish with balansol solution until the vitrectomy ports are made and fluid air exchange is done. And then this is hand fashioned to a size slightly larger than the macular hole diameter. And under air, this capsular flap is placed with a drop of viscoelastic. You can see with a drop of viscoelastic, this is introduced and placed over the macular hole. Again, this acts as a scaffold for the migration of Müller cells and closure of the macular hole. Advantage with anterior capsular, posterior capsular flap is that it is slightly thicker and denser than the ILM and doesn't get dislodged from the macular. Here you can see under the scaffold, the hole closes under this. So also rarely it has been described in large myopic macular holes with posterior staphyloma, where the contrast is very less and already failed surgery, getting the ILM and putting on the hole is difficult. In such situation, from the supratemporal equatorial area, after cauterization, a small flap, retinal full thickness flap, is taken under PFCL and placed over the macula. And over time, it has been shown that under the retinal free flap, the refractory macular hole closes, especially in the posterior staphylomatous eye with long axial length. This has been described with success. So arcuate retinotomy described by the Charles Skippens, Steve Charles, this along the nerve fiber bundle in the temporal to the macular hole, a C-shaped incision is made, and with the soft tip, this retinal tissue bridge is displaced nasally so that the horizontal diameter reduces and results in the closure of macular hole. It doesn't cause scotoma in the macular area. And radial incision starting at around a diameter, macular hole diameter away from the lips of the macular hole, sparing the papillomacular bundle, also has been described relaxing retinal incision in recalcitrant macular holes. The adjuvants usually used are, as we saw, viscoelastic or autologous platelet concentrate or whole blood. This is to prevent the dislocation of the transplanted tissue during the FAE or during the postoperative period. So to conclude, the above described techniques prove useful, especially for large and refractory macular holes, which had poor prognosis in the past. And these techniques reveal advancement in surgical techniques with better anatomic outcome. But long-term functional outcomes in larger studies needs to be evaluated yet. So thank you for patient listening.
Check. Any questions to Dr. Jaj? Actually, Dr. Jaj, actually, this macular hole is becoming the organic dustbin of the eye, actually. So whatever you find, you drop it. So what is your most preferred technique? Which one you fill it with?
our technique is the most popular one, which we described a modified technique under PFCL bubble.
Right. Free
flap technique and put it on the macula. And then gas tamponade. Most of the time, that only is sufficient to create a scaffold and close the macular hole. The other techniques are for really recalcitrant hole, including retinal free flap. We have two cases done retinal free flap, but those were re-RDs operated with already ILM peeled, and that patient has gone for re-RD under oil. So the oil removal and doing, it was very easy to take a retinal flap from the edge of the retinectomy and placed over the macula, that also closed the macular hole. So whether capsular flap transplantation or retinal free flap, but the easiest thing is ILM flap.
Okay. I've got two questions for you. One is, when you're doing the free flap, if it misses, what you do? That is question number one. You're doing a free flap.
You mean under the PFCL?
No, at the end of the surgery, when you're doing fluid air exchange also, suddenly it is sucked through your...
Then you'll have to re-peel again and put it on the macula.
Right. My second question is, if it fails again, you are talking about the first failure. What about the second failure?
So that's a question, actually.
So if you put some PFCL and from the below the PFCL, you take the flap and below the PFCL just...
That's a technique that is shown actually.
No, in spite
but
of
he is asking if that also fails, then whether to take the patient up again for a surgery. We don't have an experience. If anybody has an experience on, probably that radial. Arcuate retinotomy by Steve Charles or something would be. But I don't have personal experience of a failed. Re-grafting technique.
We have gone for autologous, but my question is how many failures you can withstand, or when will you wash up the case is the question.
So
because many a times it happens.
Sometimes the patient will be the deciding factor, actually, not we. First fail surgery, it's easy to convince for a re-surgery, but a re-transplanted ILM or capsular flap or a retinal free flap failed, then it's a difficult question to answer, actually, how to manage that.
Probably, I think you should have an ICR, multiple failed surgeries. Thank you, Dr. George.
The next speaker is Dr. V. S. Saravanan, professor and senior consultant in Aurobindo Eye Hospital, Coimbatore. Okay, and his subject is macular hole and scisis in myopia, optic nerve pit, and subretinal PFCL removal.
Thank you, Abhijit. So I have done I have done three surgeries. The first was in a myopic macular hole. First time we did ILM inverse flap failed. Then finally did a retinal autograft.
Okay.
And it succeeded. But I have done maximum than three interventions, not more than that. Yeah. The problem is every time you ask the patient to do surgery, 15-20 days you are in prone position, they get tired. All these are mostly old people and they get really tired and they sort of give up.
Yeah.
And you also have to think about the patient also. You cannot always think about only the hole. You have to think about the patient as a person also. It's not like,
We have to take care of our EMI also. No, other thing is this autologous, retina.
Retina.
Again, I keep telling actually, when you're doing that, you should drag properly because if the flap is flipped.
That also is under PFCL, no?
Yeah.
Under
same.
PFCL.
If it's upside down, then
you will see the brain instead of what is there happening. That is the only problem. You have to be very careful.
One technique described by the Egyptian group was instead of doing a fluid exchange, that's the time where it gets lost. So they did a direct PFCL oil exchange. So that the flap does not float away. So that also is one of the options. Even though I have not done, one of the Egyptian surgeons, they described doing a direct, instead of going for a fluid air exchange, a direct PFCL into oil exchange to prevent loss of the retinal graft. Okay, so thanks. I'll be talking in a few of these topics which already Avijit mentioned. So we have a sizable number of myopic population, and a lot of times we don't do a OCT as a routine investigation in these patients. So whenever a patient complains of a high myopic patient complains of unexplained visual loss where the fundus and everything looks okay, always don't hesitate to do a OCT to see all these changes in the posterior pole of the eye. So here you can see that the early contracture of the pointer or something. Now you have the early content. No, it's okay. You can see the contracture of the unlike in older when we were doing a postgraduate, we always thought that PVD is very common in high myopes, but it's not true. PVD is the least common high myopes, and what happens is you have an anomalous PVD, and the sky tick posterior cortex, vitreous cortex, becomes very thick and starts to contract, causing traction here, and it can lead to early traction, where you can see the early traction here and the schisis, which is about to start here, again, small space about to start with the alteration in the architecture. And even more, in one more case where you can see a little bit more severe, you can see that the schisis is more intense here and the separation is much more intense. And you can see this is the even more prominent schisis with the formation of a lamellar macular hole. And you can see here it is the hole is led to a form of a posterior pole retinal detachment. So this is the only condition where a macular hole itself can produce a detachment, unlike in other case, emmetrope, if you have a macular hole, it is secondary to the detachment rather than the cause of the detachment. Myopia with the posterior staphyloma is where you have a macular hole causing a detachment. So multiple terms have been used to describe this diseased entity, like schisis, fovea schisis, myopic macular schisis. And now the more accepted terminology is the MTM or the myopic traction maculopathy to encompass all these changes which we right now saw. So you can see this high definition OCT showing the myopic CNVM here. But apart from that, you have the stiff hyoid and the myopic macular schisis, which is splitting up the inner layers, even a much more severe disease in the lower part of the eye. And you can see the various cuts showing the extensive schisis here. So a lot of times people tend to maintain good vision in these cases. Once the vision starts dropping, you will have to intervene. So a lot of theories of why this happens. One is that the ILM becomes stiff. The vitreous is the main culprit here. Apart from that, even the because of the extension of the axial of the eye, the vessels also sort of cause blood, normal blood vessels also cause of some amount of traction leading to the schisis. So there are various theories which have been there. And ILM as a peeling as ensures both the release of the traction and also removal of the vitreous scaffold which is contracting in the above this. And vitrectomy is one of the major surgery which is performed to relax these tractional forces. So people have shown that just peeling the vitreous is enough to, no need to peel the ILM. There's one of the cases in the study where they did only vitrectomy by staining the vitreous by using a triamcinolone and resolution of the sky tick cavity after surgery. So people also have tried this one other case from the series showing the resolution of the detachment after just without ILM peeling. So also ILM peeling also has been shown to be effective, mainly to release, it ensures that you remove all the vitreous without leaving any residual sky hyaloid. Instead of staining with TA, you can also do the ILM peeling to confirm. And this one, again, one more case where showing the resolution of the schisis following surgery. So always when you're doing this, you have to make sure that your visibility is very good. So the contact lens is one of the best lenses to visualize these, both the ILM as well as sky tick vitreous in these eyes. Because routine non-contact wide angle system tends to lose out on the depth perception. And because of the loss of contrast, I usually prefer to inject the PFCL and then stain. Because if the PFCL, the stain migrates under the subretinal space, it causes loss of contrast. You can see as I am peeling the ILM here, you can see the resistance which is happening here because of the vitreous there. So you can see now the vitreous is coming off, and then you can restart peeling the ILM. So PFCL helps to not only stabilize the retina during the peeling technique, but also it prevents the migration because there is no choroid here, and migration of the dye under the macula can lead to loss of contrast and much more difficult visualization when doing this surgery. So also people have been trying to push the eye from behind. So a lot of PLOMs have been described, and there's one small video showing the placement of the PLOM. So it is anchored at the just behind the lateral rectus muscle, and then it has got a sort of C shape where they have a. So a lot of people do combined surgeries here, both the ILM peeling combined with the external PLOM. So to support, it's called the macular buckle. You can see this is it's the guidance. They use the endolight to guide it to place it right on the macula. So if you place it a little bit more nasal, you can hit the optic nerve and cause optic neuropathy. If you are more temporal, there's no tamponading effect. So correct placement is of great importance in placing a macular plomb. So this is a sort of a C shape which is just anchored at the just behind the temporal, and you can see now the light is showing it's right in the correct place. And then you suture it to the sclera in the just behind this. So multiple OCTs showing the resolution of the macular hole and schisis following the placement of the plomb. So it can either be internal or external or combined, depending upon the, so if a macular hole is there, you have to do combined surgery. Only this case is probably you can get away with doing an external plomb also. But right now, plomb is not very popular in India. So next is the optic disc maculopathy, which has been not very uncommon, but problem is a lot of times you see that failure of multiple surgeries after doing laser, ILM peeling, vitrectomy with gas and oil. So the source of fluid is assumed to be from the vitreous cavity, showing the, because the fluid tends to go into the retina as well as under the retina. So initially, what we were doing in the earlier days was when your fellows was to do a barrage temple to the optic disc, at the, just adjacent to the to cut off the supply leaking from the optic into the retina. Then later on, we did only plain gas injection with prone positioning. Then after that, we did plain vitrectomy with gas injection. And then now we do ILM peeling, but ILM peeling also did not show that much of a success. So this is one of the cases, the earlier cases, the 20 gauge surgery, where we are just doing ILM peeling for the optic nerve pit. But now what we do is usually try to stuff the pit with either one of these materials, that is the sclera or the ILM. So sclera tends to be much more effective in dealing this. This is one of the cases where only a plain ILM peeling was done stuffing, but you can see what happened after the surgery. You can see this is the ILM peeling is involving the fovea. So to stuff this, supposedly you're stuffing this into the optic disc pit. But you can see what happened postoperatively was that because the ILM peeling involved the macula, you can see a secondary macula hole which is developed here. So nowadays what we do is we try to peel sparing the macula. So it's a fovea sparing ILM peel. As you can see here, the fovea is spared from the ILM peel so that only a nasal flap is taken so that the fovea is not involved. Thereby can sort of preserve the fovea from going in for this thing. So now which is more popular and much more effective is the scleral flap, which we have here. You can see the small flap is being taken from the adjacent to the limbus, and this is fashioned according to the size of the hole, pit rather. And then this, you need not even do ILM peeling, you can just do a plain vitrectomy induced PVD, and then because it's quite heavy, it doesn't float off like the ILM, and you can just place it and slightly push it into the optic disc pit to sort of tamponade that and prevent. So one of the cases she's showing resolution after the, that you can see the scleral graft sitting on the pit there and the resolution of the ischiasis and the this thing. The last thing is the PFCL. So a lot of times after a successful surgery, we see that after, because of the bubbling which you're doing during exchange of instruments, we see that the PFCL is migrated under the fovea. Outside external PFCL, we don't bother, but under the fovea, it's going to compromise, going to photoreceptor atrophy, going to compromise postoperative visual recovery. So we have 2-3 techniques to take care of this. So don't hesitate to do it immediately after surgery. Don't wait for this thing. So one is to inject a small bubble of PFCL to create iatrogenic RD, and then mobilize the PFCL with a soft tip into the central of the bullae, and then aspirate it from that small retinotomy. You can use a 27 gauge aspiration, soft tip aspiration cannula to do this. Or else we have the 38 or 41 gauge needle to do this. If you don't have that, this is Abhijit's technique, where we break this 30 gauge needle and hook it onto a 24 gauge intramuscular needle in case you don't have the access to the Med1 38 or 40 or 41 gauge needle. They have three types, 38, 40 and 41. So if you don't have that, you can do this where you have to shape it so that it's parallel to the RP at the level of the macula. And this is then, can use either a silicone injector or an external sister can use a external syringe to inject this. So usually this is the second post-op day of successful RD surgery. So oil is still inside. So we are doing a two-port vitrectomy, for the one for the light and one for the this needle for creating artificial bullae there, iatrogenic RD there. So it should be plain parallel to the level of the RPE. As you inject, you see a small bullae forming there. And then, so because a small bubble there, so you cannot use directly a direct aspiration. So for small bubbles, we prefer this bullet technique. Then now you can slightly use your soft tip to nudge it into the center of the bullet, the PFCL bubble from the fovea, and then you can aspirate it from that. So once you aspirate, along with the subretinal fluid, the PFCL bubble also is sucked into the soft tip. So for large bubbles, you can directly aspirate it from the edge itself. The last slide is. So small bubbles, you may not want to create a large. So this is a large bubble in a pediatric case, again, a pediatric RD. You can see that the bubble is quite large. So here you can just poke it at the edge of the either 27 gauge needle or directly with the 48 gauge needle and then directly aspirate it. So you make sure that you don't leave these bubbles because it's going to compromise final visual acuity. So you just make a small nick and using your soft tip, so this is, I'm using a 27 gauge suction, but you can also use the directly the 38 gauge needle also, whichever you feel is comfortable to you. The last technique is you don't really want to remove it, you just create a small bullae inferior to the fovea and then nudge it into the bullae and position the patient in sitting position immediate post-op so that it is migrated out of the fovea into the extra foveal location. So you don't try to actually remove it by anacillicating any retinotomies. These three are techniques we follow to deal with subretinal PFCL. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saravanan. So our questions we will take at last. In fact, you can put down your questions in paper. And next I will call Dr. Shubhankar Sripal. He's a senior consultant of Priyamvada Birla Aurobindo Eye Hospital and an accomplished surgeon. Dr. Paul will tell about the submacular hemorrhage management, the medical part, like anti-VEGF, TPA, and the gas. Thank you.
Good morning. I'll be discussing on submacular hemorrhage, role of TPA, gas, and anti-VEGF. I have no financial interest. So submacular hemorrhage is hemorrhage in the potential space between the neurosensory retina and the RPE. It can be caused by the neovascular AMD and PCV most commonly, then retinal artery microaneurysm, trauma, myopia, and injured streak. It may lead to the photoreceptor damage within 24 hours by sharing of outer segment of photoreceptor, impaired transport of nutrients, direct toxicity by iron, fibrin, and simosiderin. So timely intervention is extremely important. Treatment options available are anti-VEGF monotherapy, pneumatic displacement with anti-VEGF therapy, intravitreal TPA with anti-VEGF and pneumatic displacement, or parsplana vitrectomy with subretinal TPA with subretinal or intravitreal pneumatic displacement. Natural history has a very poor visual outcome. There is no gold standard treatment. Monotherapy with anti-VEGF showed some success. Anti-VEGF treats the underlying pathology. Expansile gas causes mechanical displacement of blood from the fovea, so there is faster visual recovery, and it may even cause flattening of hemorrhagic PEDs. It allows to show, view the underlying pathology and perform the related investigations and treatment as per requirement. Anti-VEGF with gas has shown better results, but there is no head-to-head prospective trial. A CAD trial subgroup of patients with submacular hemorrhage had favorable outcome. TPA was first described by Wilson Harriet with intravitreal 0.1 ml, which catalyzes the breakdown of plasminogen to plasmin to cause clot lysis, liquefies the subretinal clot and hasten resorption of pre-existing hemorrhage. Intravitreal TPA with or without gas or anti-VEGF result is very good in small hemorrhage with shorter duration. Subretinal TPA following vitrectomy used in large, long-standing and more severe form of hemorrhage causes chemical lysis of clot with minimal mechanical trauma. Side effects may be photoreceptor cell loss, RPE pigmentary changes, exudative retinal detachment or hemorrhage, which are dose dependent. The vitrectomy allows a larger gas bubble. Three-line improvement in visual improvement is noted in 66% of population with submacular hemorrhage. No clear difference, but there is no clear difference between the vitrectomy with subretinal TPA versus intravitreal TPA without vitrectomy. But it has got advantage of subretinal pneumatic displacement, which exerts higher pressure, more effective after TPA assisted clot lysis. Then prolonged phase down positioning is not required and less chance of IOP rise, but there is high risk of macular hole formation. Vitrectomy with subretinal TPA with PFCL has been used to displace subfoveal blood. So we have few cases. First case is a 55-year-old female who came with 15 days history of decreased vision with 636 vision, known hypertensive, came with the left eye huge submacular hemorrhage, OCT showing multiple PEDs with subfoveal hemorrhage. So she was treated at first with intravitreal gas with anti-VEGF. 2 weeks later, vision improved to 6/18, but not much of displacement of submacular hemorrhage. So injection TPA was given intravitreally. 1 month post-injection, vision improved, but still there is persistent submacular hemorrhage. FFA showed a hyperfluorosis, but there is no definite diagnosis. Second dose of anti-VEGF was given. Post-injection, 7 days, injection C3F8 was added. Later on, after 1 month, ICG was done, which did not show any polyp or BVN. So provisional diagnosis of retinal artery macroaneurysm or AMD was made and received third dose of injection ranibizumab. Subsequently received 2 more doses of ranibizumab and vision improved to 6/9 with complete disappearance of submacular hemorrhage. Second case of a 75-year-old lady, known hypertensive with 1 month history of submacular hemorrhage with finger counting vision, FFA done elsewhere showing retinal artery macroaneurysm. So she was treated first with intravitreal gas with intravitreal TPA and anti-VEGF, but still not much of improvement. So C3F8 was re-injected, but still there is no improvement. So vitrectomy was done with subretinal TPA with C3F8 and aflibercept. So this video is showing a 23-gauge vitrectomy. After removal of the vitreous, the trichode-assisted complete removal of vitreous was done. Then special cannula was used, what Dr. Sarvanan had shown. The 30-gauge cannula was introduced in the 24-gauge cannula and subretinal TPA was injected. Hemostasis was secured and fluid air exchange was done. So subsequently, 2 more aflibercept was given, vision improved to 6/18, and there is complete disappearance of submacular hemorrhage. Case 3 at a 73-year-old male patient, known diabetic, 10 days history of huge submacular hemorrhage with finger counting vision, FFA showing triple hyperfluorescence, ICG showing multiple cluster polyps with a huge PED and subfoveal hemorrhage. So initially was treated with intravitreal anti-VEGF with gas with strict prone positioning. Unfortunately, patient developed breakthrough vitreous hemorrhage with RPE RIP. Then the vitrectomy was planned with intravitreal gas and second dose of anti-VEGF. 1 month post-injection, vision was 2/60, but the hemorrhage has resolved. TPA was not used. So to summarize, we can see the patient with AMD had a poor visual outcome. TPA was not used in all cases, but still the anatomical success could be achieved. So visual prognosis was better in patient with shorter duration and lesser retinal damage. Anatomical success could be achieved. Subretinal TPA was very effective in long-standing cases, especially when intravitreal failed. All the procedure has relatively less complication other than having a breakthrough vitreous hemorrhage or RPE RIP. So to conclude, timely intervention is extremely important. Intravitreal gas is effective in displacement of blood, but may require multiple injections. Anti-VEGF has big role in treating the underlying pathology. TPA is effective in dissolution of blood clot, but may not be mandatory in all cases. Subretinal TPA is more effective and safe in refractory cases. And visual prognosis ultimately depends on underlying pathology, presence of sub-RPE blood, duration of hemorrhage, size of hemorrhage, and available facility.
Thank you, Dr. Subhankar. So our last topic is Dr. Naresh Babu. He's a professor and HOD of Aurobindo Eye Hospital, Madurai Department of Retina and Vitreous. And his topic is management of the submacular hemorrhage surgically.
In the meanwhile, it's getting. Thank you, Abhijit, for the invitation. So the disadvantage of being the last speaker is most of the time previous speaker would have taken all the time, and you will be left with very little time. But I would like to thank all my co-speakers because they have given us a long time. And of course, there is another advantage also. Being a last speaker, the people who are going to attend the next IC will be coming and sitting, waiting for us to vacate, and we think that they have come to listen to us, actually. Yeah, thank you, the people who have come for the next IC.
You have full 20 minutes to yourself now.
Okay, close. Somebody's, okay. Now, another disadvantage is like when you're the last speaker, especially with a common topic, all your slides would have been already presented by the previous speakers. So we'll be left with, we'll see how many are repeating. So as usual, there is no disclosure. So this is basically the presence of hemorrhage between the RP and the neurosensory retina. If it is under the RP, it's going to be difficult. Actually, there are a lot of causes, and most common will be AMD, but if it's not very large and if it's not involving the fovea, we're not going to treat it surgically. And very commonly, we do the submacular surgery in case of PCV, because usually the bleeding is so intense, and if you see in case of other vitreous hemorrhage, the blood will remain red for a longer time, but in case of PCV, they become dehemoglobinized quite early, and you will have to go for surgical management. And most of these cases, I'll tell you later, it's not an elective procedure. Sort of, you will have a surprise on the table, and then you decide, yes, we are going for submacular surgery, and again, it depends on your mood also. And if you're so tired on that day, you'll say, okay, let us inject anti-VEGF, we'll see what happens. The other causes are high myopia, trauma, et cetera. And when you're doing a buccal surgery also, it's a very disastrous complication. When we're doing taking a bite deep, or when you're doing a blind drainage, there is always a chance of the blood seeping between the retina and the choroid. So what we usually do is we don't drain the subretinal fluid completely. So in such cases, if there is some fluid remaining between the retina and the RP, and if you inject the gas or air, usually it displaces, and if the buccal is well supported, yes, the retina also reattaches. Otherwise, you'll have to go for the surgery. And in penetrating trauma, there is always a problem. So there, the thing is, additionally, you will have suprachoroidal hemorrhage also. If there is a suprachoroidal hemorrhage, wait for 5 to 7 days for the blood to lyse, and then we can tackle both. So these are the other causes where we come across this, but they are not usually massive. Unless otherwise it involves the fovea, will not be doing it surgically. This has been discussed earlier. Actually, there are basically three forces, the factors which lead to the loss of vision in these cases. What Ryan says is you have to operate within 24 hours, but we never get that opportunity to operate on these patients within 24 hours, even if it is trauma. Because by 24 hours, all this damage would have happened due to all these three factors. So in order to get back the vision, earlier the surgery is better. So depending upon the size of the involvement, we can grade into mild or moderate or severe, and usually in case of severe only, we go for surgery. There are certain prognosticating factors. If the hemorrhage is less than 2 weeks, yes, when you operate, usually they do well, and the patients with good visual acuity prior, when we operate, they get good vision. But if the blood is relatively thicker and it's of a longer duration, then usually the outcome is bad. So there are a lot of treatment options which has been discussed. You just inject a gas or TPA, everything. So I'll just skip because it has been discussed. So this is one of the cases of a choroidal rupture with subretinal bleed. And the blood is not very much. So in this case, we have injected gas. Usually I prefer SF6, make the patient prone. And what happens is by 1 or 2 weeks time, it clears off. Unfortunately, in this, the choroidal rupture is going temporal to the fovea. Usually, outcome is good. But if it is passing through the fovea, then the outcome is bad. And sometimes, maybe by 8 months or 12 months, if you see these patients will develop CNVM also. Usually, they respond well to the injection. The injection. So we'll go directly to the surgery. I'll come to this video later. Usually, we plan for submacular surgery as an elective procedure, provided the media is clear. You are seeing the blood under the fovea, and it's quite large. But many a times, in case of PCV, I have told already, it's going to be a surprise when you operate. Then, once you clear the vitreous hemorrhage, then you will find. So this is a case where a PCV hemorrhage. So initially, this was operated with the Engine T system. After clearing the vitreous hemorrhage, usually I wash with the tricot a lot, because this is not only in this case. In every other case, if you find the deposits of the tricot over the retina like this, that means definitely there is some vitreous left. So usually I wash it with the tricot to identify the sciatic vitreous. And if it is difficult, you just scrape it with the tannos, and then you can peel it with your cutter. The reason why I'm saying is when you're going to do a retinectomy in these cases, there should not be even a single fiber of vitreous. And this is the same thing what Abhijit has been doing. Previously, we were using 44 gauge needle, but now it's not available or it's quite expensive. So what we do is mounting 30 gauge on a 24 gauge. And I usually connect it to the silicon oil injector because it is more controlled than manual injection because you can mechanically inject. So what we do is we induce the retinal detachment. So care to be taken not to go under the RP. If you're going to go under the RP, you're going to detach the RP. So the plane should be perfect. I think I am lucky in this case because the plane was perfect. Once we do the fluid air exchange, all these bubbles coalesce to form a nice detachment. And with the diatomy, go for a, as far as possible, we are going to create a giant retinal tear in the periphery. And in this case, once it is done, there are a lot of techniques. See, everything is fair in war and love. We have to include surgery also, because you might say, I do like this, I do like that. Everybody does it in their own way. This is the way I do it, actually. So what we do is just scrape it with the tannos, fold the retina over the disc. And in this case, the hemorrhage was quite heavy. So what we do is we inject PFCL so that we can stabilize the retina. Once the retina is stabilized, you can see the entire retina is on the nasal side, and this is the subretinal bleed. Okay, so the retina is on the temporal side, yes. Now, you can just peel it in this case, but fortunately there was not much of RP stripped with this. Sometimes the entire RP strips, so we'll have to go for RP transplant also. The biggest challenge is removing this membrane because it is very thick and chewy actually. Many times we'll have to exchange the cutter to 20 gauge to chew this completely. Once it is done, okay, now this was done in two stages. Nowadays, most of the surgeries are done in two stages. In the sense, first we go, after doing the surgery, you just inject PFCL and the, back. So once it is done, we inject PFCL and it is treated like a giant retinal tear. So what we usually do is we keep the PFCL and over that, maybe 1 or 2 ml, we top up with silicon oil. That's it. So you wait for a week or so. In this case, I think we have waited for 5 days because even for GRT, we do that. Yeah, in this case, we have waited for 5 days. Once it is done, the surgery is repeated because it makes the blood to completely displace. It attaches the retina well. So what happens is we remove the rest of the thing, add some lasers if needed. You remove the silicon oil, whatever is injected, and the PFCL, you can see, the one we have injected 5 days ago, just remove it. And it is refilled with the oil. So this is at the end of the surgery, you clean a, get a clean macula, check the IOP and close it. So most of the surgeries we do in two stages so that no blood remains over the macula. And as I was telling, it's basically always a, surprise. In this case, I think one of the earliest cases, so it's again, actually, if you see there is submacular hemorrhage, so you induce the giant retinal tear. There is nothing different, actually, but in this case, we have done with the 44 gauge. You can make out the 44 gauge polyamide and induce the retinal detachment. So inducing retinal detachment is the trick. Don't go too deep. It'll go under the RP. Then it becomes disastrous. So it should be between the retina and the RP. So once it is done, yeah. Keep injecting with your BSS filled with the 5 ml silicon oil injector. Once it is done, you create a retinal detachment, pull it to the other side, and just remove the, the membrane. As I've told, the membrane is difficult to chew most of the time. So these are some of the post-op. This is the first post-op of the previous case, which was done, which had a massive hemorrhage. And this is what I was telling, actually, this was operated by one of the fellows, actually. The pre-op was looking like this. So in the ultrasound, there is a vitreous hemorrhage with almost a total PVD, with there is something in the submacular area. So once he went inside, yeah, he thought it's a vitreous hemorrhage, and he has done the laser also. After doing that, I was called. So when I saw that, this is the membrane we have, actually, under the fovea. So we induced the PVD, and the rest is the same, actually. See, this is the membrane which has been removed. So if you see, it's very difficult to chew, actually. In this case, I think I'll have to make a small opening to remove the membrane. So we have tried frag also in this case. Sometimes we use frag, even though the mechanism is different. Yes, but sometimes it helps. So tough to remove. And then you treat it like a giant retinal tear. So these are some of the cases where we have done. like the previous studies about subacute surgery is not really encouraging, but because those days they chose the very bad prognosticated cases. But now if you're going to choose a case quite early, and even if the vision is good, if you want to remove, yes, usually the outcome is good. So in conclusion, usually the natural history is variable. So as far as possible, actually you go for early surgery. And when you see the benefit, actually they say it's minimal, but we don't have a RCT as of now. When we start doing it now, we'll get a better results with these cases. And there are a lot of alternate procedures also, like macular translocation or RP patch grafting. And they give a mixed, response to the treatment in these cases. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nares. Before taking question, I'd like to ask another time for Professor Ilad Moiseev, whether he's present or not. Our keynote speaker, we missed him. Sorry, no problem. So Professor Moiseev is there.
So I'd like to ask one question to Naresh. So you're doing a study on the efficacy of retinal autograft for large macular holes. Can you share the outcome of those?
No, actually, we have done almost now 15 or 16 cases. See, everybody claims tall results, but when we see with what you call microperimetry, the pre and post, there is not much of difference as of now. Actually, maybe we'll have to wait for 6 months. Now we have got maybe 4 to 5 months follow-up of the first case with the pre and post microperimetry, but usually the result is not really encouraging. And same question actually last year, Dr. Jaj, that is 2018, we had 3 or 4 publications. Everybody dumps the idea of, including us, we have published one in BMC, the other one from Retina from Eli Prasad, and another meta analysis. Everybody says there is no great advantage in doing ILM flap, I mean inverse flap for macular. So what is your take on that? Because our results were not in, it closes, but it never improves.
Yeah, as I already mentioned, the long-term visual outcomes of these patients need to be studied. When you look at these articles, I mean, almost whichever institute it has come, we hardly have 6 months. I mean, post-op, usually inclusion is 6 months. We need to see the what is the final visual outcome on a long-term. Anatomically, we know it all closes. But then visual outcomes are not in larger studies, in large numbers, actually. And I have a question for Naresh. You said, what is the advantage of, is it that the blood clears because you have PFCL inside? Two-stage procedure you're talking about. You could do a silicone oil PFCL exchange at the end of it rather than keeping the PFCL. What is the advantage that you move the blood from the macula, displacing the blood under the macula?
Right. So the basic thing is, I think you know very well, like all GRTs now we started moving towards two-stage. Because by 5 days time, actually the adhesion is so firm that it never detaches. So in this case, the main reason for doing two stages, one is the blood. The second is we have created a 180-degree GRT. So it is basically for treating the GRT. You leave it for just 5 to 7 days. What we get is amazing. Now we are doing a randomized trial where we are comparing this two stage. At the end of 5 days, we remove the PFCL and the silicone oil and no tamponade after that. They do well, actually. So your tamponade is only 5 days required for these cases.
Any questions from the audience? Yeah, please.
So when you do two-stage surgery for GRT, so in the second stage you put oil or you just remove?
No, that's what we are doing, both the things. In second stage, in one arm, we are injecting the oil. In another arm, we remove it and just leave it.
Okay, so that is the comparative group, not
exactly
with the conventional one-stage technique.
No.
Have you included gas in any of this?
No. I don't know, like, see, even Westerners, everybody says that we inject gas, but when we go to their OR, everybody injects oil, actually. So I feel more.
No. In your third arm, no, you have one group you are putting oil,
yeah.
Other in no tamponade.
No tamponade.
Not
no.
Gas.
No, I'm really scared of gas because the PVR under gas is so scary for me. Yeah. No, almost to the brim of the GRT. Just 1 ml will be the top of oil. That is basically not to allow the PFCL to come into the ACR to, so I mean, contain its mobility.
So, pipe position.
Yeah, yeah, that is more convenient for the patient, especially for children.
That blood removal from the macula is a really logic because, I mean, there is a gravitational and pressing effect of the heavier PFCL, but I don't know, recurrent rate of RD, I don't know whether if you directly oil PFCL exchange also slipping won't happen and
definitely
we have to look at the study result.
Yeah.
One more regarding the inverse flap, temporal flap, I've not done a vision comparative study, but what I have seen in my case of temporal flap was the deeper layers anatomy was well restored in temporal flap compared to the inverse flap. I feel the anatomical restoration is much more, normalization is much more with the temporal flap compared to the older stuffing
technique
where you do inverse
flap.
Yeah.
Even some literature also says that
in our own cases, you have seen
temporal single flap over the macula is better than.
Add some question.
Especially if the GRTs are fresh and experienced, yeah. I don't hesitate in putting gas. In fact, some of my GRTs are put even short-acting gas and they do really well.
No, I have told in the disclaimer actually, everything is fair in war and love and we have to do surgery in surgery also.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. So everybody has got their own technique. Whatever works actually. So it's a fair idea.
With the oil, I think only advantage, if you feel like doing some extra laser, you can do it.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, patient is less scared. Their relatives and to us also, because I cannot see anything for 1 month.
I think being in an institute.
Yeah. So those two things basically we have to manage.
Yeah.
That's all.
So
otherwise,
being in institute, that thing we can take care of.
That is an institute, but when the patient goes back to his relatives, that thing.
That again, I think it's to do with the counseling. If you counsel the patient well before the surgery, then.
So gas, you're
no,
a little choosy
about
the patient.
Counseling is not that easy actually, because on POD1. When we inject the gas for the macular hole, I keep telling them for next 13 to 15 days, you'll be seeing a black bubble. You believe me or not, within 4 or 5 days, the patient will come and say that I am having something round inside my eye.
Yeah, that is universal, but you just have to explain that.
Yeah. The only thing is, we'll have to give them a question paper and conduct exam at the end of counseling, whether they have understood it or not.
I fully agree.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
My question is to Dr. Abhijit Chattopadhyay. Have you had a dislodgement of the 31 gauge needle intraocular?
No. Basically, what happens whenever we put it outside, you just inject it maybe with a visco and see how much it's stable.
Okay.
And then you may have to
bend
it.
It's very tough. Once you put it inside, even if you want to pull it out, it will not pull it out. It's so tough to pull it out.
No, you don't keep it very straight, everything. You have to bend it because they bend it and then try to pull it out with the needle holder, it will not come out.
The bending involves both the 24 as well as the 30 gauge.
Yeah.
So even if you want to readjust that distance, it will not come out.
So both sides we have to.
It needs really massive force to pull it out.
Yeah.
No, otherwise this guy would have presented it as an unusual intraocular in some conference.
Next time we can include that.
Sarun, I have got a question because we have got another 10 minutes to go. Now, in case of high myopia, it's so difficult to stain because of the choroidal atrophy. So do you have any different strategy of staining, maybe the longer duration or heavy BPGR with the...
That's what I don't know. I always stain for high myopes where the choroid is very, very white. I mean, like atrophied and white background. I always do PFCL. And stain on the under the PFCL so that the stain does not escape anywhere. It tends to remain there and it gives a much more denser stain compared to what you would inject under water.
And another technique is multiple time staining.
Yeah, that also is there.
Also.
But how do you get those forceps to hold them?
Yeah, forceps you have, lot of local companies making. You can make it according to recommend. They have 34 and 36. 32, 34 and 36 they have. Usually 34 and 36 is enough to reach most of the macula. Some of the other techniques, you have to remove your cannula, the
trocar
cannula, the cannula part, so that you can gain at least another 1 to 1.5 millimeters.
Okay.
And you can, if you have a, you can slightly shift it from normal 3 to 3.5, you can go till 4 to 4.5. You can visualize the, press and visualize the ora serrata, and then you go a little bit more posterior. And temporal axis is much more shorter than the nasal axis. Even in the left eye, if you are good using left hand, like Abhijit is very good in his left hand, you can go from the left hand to do the ILM peeling. So if you are good in the left hand. So temporal axis gives you a shorter axis compared to the nasal because you have to cross over the disc and reach the macula. So these are some of the techniques. Use a longer forceps, remove the cannula and a posterior location and temporal axis. All these will help you to reach closer to
the ILM, you give some retrovalvar injection also.
Retrovalvar? Yeah, it'll what
will
float up.
Yeah.
Actually.
Regarding the staining part, can you put in the BPG and then put
So no, we want the, if it's a pre-existing macular hole is there, we want the PFCL, I'm sorry, we want the dye not to go under the retina. Because already the choroid is absent here. If the dye goes, it'll cause constant staining, so you won't know where you're peeled and where you're not peeled. So the loss of this counter contrast is lost. So it's best to use under PFCL rather than directly injecting.
Other indication is our 20 gauge instrument, which has been abandoned long time. We have got a big armamentarium. So in all these cases of high myo,
can probably go, yeah.
So they are very useful actually. So if you have got
yeah,
old
much more longer.
Of, they are much longer actually.
Much longer
in such
actually.
Cases.
There's no restriction for the length. It's really
yeah,
long actually.
It's
yeah.
Long, really long actually. So
okay.
If you have got the old microscopes left, just get it.
Manvi, yeah.
Stuffing.
I usually stuff.
Yeah, I think so.
And all recurrences, I go for a retinal graft.
First
surgery fails, I don't hesitate to go for, I don't do repeat free flap and all.
Uh-huh.
First, I directly do inverse flap. If it fails, I directly go for retinal graft. There's no in between.
Sir, talk about the LHAP as well, the surgical part.
Yeah, LHAP, I don't know, what you want to discuss something? No.
No, I didn't.
LHAP,
I
you have
mentioned.
To identify. A lot of times, people don't actually take time to look at the OCT and identify. You have this small layer of spongy proliferation. And during ERM peeling, you'll see that yellow color xanthophyll pigment is sort of stripping off. You'll think that you're tearing off the retina. So you have to make sure that you see the previous OCT, you realize that you have LHAP. So you're peeling, you'll not have that fear that you're unnecessarily tearing off the retina because xanthophyll keeps on coming out.
Most important, one more thing is to identify the LHAP, it will not have the hyper-reflective, well-defined membrane. It will
spongy.
Be seen as a less mm-hmm. hyper-reflective, almost slightly more than the retinal tissue sensitivity, and it will be on the surface. So that doesn't have great prognosis even with a with
second
surgery.
Point is, like a normal ERM, you try to avulse the piece of the ERM. But
you.
Here, you should make sure that you don't attempt that, because if you're going to avulse it is going to tear. So you just, whatever comes off freely, you just pull it off and then trim off, and with whatever leftover LHAP is that, you can stuff it.
Yeah, actually,
so don't try to avulse
the
tissue. Like
sparing kind of peeling can be...
don't try to avulse the ERM like you would normally do in a routine ERM peeling. So first is identification is very critical. Then have the confidence that you're not stripping the retina, and then don't try to avulse the tissue from the retinal surface.
So at the end of it, I want to thank everybody for listening so patiently. And I'm really sorry to keep the few questions at bay. And I will request the persons to ask the surgeons themselves personally, maybe whatever the questions, because we have to leave the stage for the next IC also. And I'll ask on photographs, please, for everybody.